He said Daniel spoke about it. So he said, from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, and what?
And the abomination that maketh desolate set up.
There you go. Set up. Go ahead.
There shall be a 1,290 days.
See, that's 3.5 years. Literal. That's what it is. 1,290 days. Just like he said, a time times and a half. Well, 90 days, you got 30 days over because it's some time in there to deal with for you to see the daily sacrifice being taken away. Because he included that in it. See, Jesus didn't say nothing about no daily sacrifice, but he told you to go back to Daniel. You get the whole story. So actually 1,260 days is exactly 3.5 years. So that's an extra month when he said 90 days, but that's because he's talking about this man taking away the daily sacrifice too. So in other words, that's probably a 30-day span from the time he stopped them from sacrificing animals, from the time he moved and take over the temple in Jerusalem. But go ahead.
Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1,305 in 30 days.
That's 45 days later. So that means it's going to take the Lord about 45 days to kill up all he's going to kill. And if you living after that time, when Jesus come back, you can rest assured you probably going to survive. It's going to be death and destruction, though, prior to that. Go ahead.
But go thy way till the end be.
Uh-huh.
For thou shalt rest and stand in thy lot at the end of the day.
See, he told Daniel, you ain't got to worry about it. You go rest and you'll get yours in the end. But it's all taking us to the end. But now, Daniel, the 8th chapter. Back up to the 8th chapter. Because he's giving you all these timetables to let you know exactly what's going on. We don't have to be in the dark. We don't have to be believing in a false theory of a rapture when God is telling you exactly what's going to happen and how you can escape it. You can escape great tribulation, and it don't have to be by no rapture. You got to make a move to the right place, and God going to provide a means for you to do it if you know. Just like he provided a way for Lot to escape Sodom and Gomorrah. Mm-hmm. Daniel 8 and verse 8. Go ahead.
Therefore the he-goat waxed very great.
Uh-huh.
And when he was strong, the great horn was broken. And for it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven.
See, now we got to get to this man again, this abomination of desolation. Because some people get confused with Antiochus. Even though he mentioned Antiochus, he's lightweight in all of this. He skip over him most of the time. So what the 8th chapter of Daniel is showing you, it's showing you, it didn't pick it up from the Babylonian Empire with Nebuchadnezzar, because he had dealt with that, started that off in the 7th chapter. But the 8th chapter took it from the Medo-Persian Empire all the way down to the second coming of Jesus. The 8th chapter of Daniel do that. So it only showed 3 world ruling empires in the 8th chapter, because it started with Babylon in the 7th chapter, the lion. So right here we at the 3rd ruling one, which is the Greek Empire, the he-goat. He said, therefore the he-goat waxed great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken. Now, the great horn was Alexander the Great. See, this is how this thing spun off. Alexander the Great had 4 generals. That's where Antiochus came up from, one of those generals. But see, it's bigger than Antiochus. That's what people need to realize. It's much bigger than Antiochus Epiphanes. He came up from one of these 4 divisions of the Greek Empire. But also, it was bigger than him because Rome came out of one of them as well. And we're going to see that. He said, and the great horn was broken, and for it came up 4 notable ones toward the 4 winds of heaven. Alexander the Great is the great horn. He got killed, and the Greek Empire splintered into 4 parts. But go ahead, verse 9.
And out of the one of them came forth a little horn.
See, and out of one of them came forth a little horn. Now, somebody might confuse this and say, well, this got to be out of the Greek Empire. No, it's bigger than the Greek Empire. This is a whole Gentile dynasty. So, and if you read Daniel the 7th chapter, which we're going to do in a little bit, the little horn only has been mentioned with the 4th empire. So it didn't come out of the 3rd empire, the Greek empire. It came out of the Roman empire. That's the little horn. This is this abomination. He is the one going to wreak all this havoc at the end. So out of one of them came forth a little horn. So in other words, when Alexander the Great died, it split off into four parts. And just simply out of one of those parts came the worst man who gonna do the worst dirt in history. Hmm. But go ahead.
Which waxed exceeding great toward the south and toward the east and toward the pleasant land.
And toward the pleasant land. But now before we go on, keep your finger here. We're gonna flip over to the 11th chapter of Daniel. Before we go any further, we're gonna show you that same scenario, but it's going to clearly bring in some other people besides Alexander the Great, four generals. Because that's what you need to understand. The little horn come from Rome, not from Greece. 11 and 4. Daniel 11 and verse 4. Go ahead.
And when he shall stand up, his kingdom shall be broken.
See, this is Alexander the Great again. Same thing we just read in the 8th chapter. When he stand up, it shall be broken. He go to 4 again. Go ahead.
And shall be divided toward the four winds of heaven.
See, that's the four generals of Alexander the Great that took over. But it was much bigger than them. See, they had to make room for this little horn and somebody else later. Go ahead.
And not to his posterity.
Not to Alexander the Great's posterity. He didn't have no child that could take over. His generals did it. Go ahead.
Nor according to his dominion, which he ruled.
Go ahead. Why?
For his kingdom shall be plucked up. Even for others beside those.
Oh, see, the Lord had this thing planned from day one. That's why Alexander the Great didn't have no heir that could take this thing over. Because he might have kept running it. But no, it went to his generals. But the goal was, he said, his kingdom, Alexander the Great's kingdom, shall be plucked up for others. Even for others besides those four generals. See, that's where the little horn come in Rome. That's where it comes from. Now go back to the 8th chapter. I just want to make sure you understand we are dealing with Rome in the end of this 8th chapter that brings us down to the end of the world, the second coming of Jesus.